From CBS 2 and Fox 28 News, this is special coverage of Flood 2016.
Good evening. We begin the Fox 28 News at 9 with a live look at the Cedar River in Vinton, which is very close to cresting. In fact, it's about 10 hours sooner than we thought. It's now at 21.3, 21.5 is the crest.
We also want you to take a look at this video. Today, the CBS 2 Fox 28 drone captured exclusive aerial footage of Cedar Rapids as the city entered the flood stage. The drone captured a look at the bridges as the water rises and different parts of the downtown area. We will continue to bring you CBS 2 Fox 28 exclusive footage like this while the floodwaters threaten Cedar Rapids.
Since our drone shot that amazing footage, the Cedar River has risen even higher right now.
Fox 28 News anchor Kevin Berry begins our flood 2016 team coverage live along the river near the Newbo District to bring us the very latest from there. Kevin?
Yes, Scott and Karen, we're just north of the Newbo District on the Cedar Valley Nature Trail, and I'll get out of the way here. You can see the Nature Trail goes underneath that rail bridge. This is the one right around 9th Avenue that goes across to the Penford plant. That goes down about 3 or 4 feet down there, but it is all solid water all the way up here. And you can get a really good look at just how nasty some of this water is. This is the reason you're not ever supposed to go into floodwaters, because it's this kind of disgusting with all these different branches and twigs that have been brought from upstream. But let's just think about how low the water is right now compared to what it's supposed to get to. It's at about 14 feet, something close to that. I'm about 5'8", 5'9". This is the first wall that's going to stop the water from getting above this into the parking lots behind us and then heading towards Newbo. So you can imagine at about 4 to 5 feet on top of me, that's how easily it's going to clear this wall. And there's a 4-foot HESCO barrier just on the other side of a parking lot that it then has to clear as well. So that we will almost certainly see water coming up over this little embankment here in the next few hours. And then it'll start heading towards Newbo, and it's anybody's guess if it'll actually get high enough to see if it'll break that HESCO barrier. But we'll just take one last look at this. This is the first piece of real flooding that we've seen on a bike trail. It hasn't affected much of downtown quite yet, but it just gives you an idea for how high the water is. And on that bridge, there's only a few feet below where the actual railway is before you start to get to water touching the bottom of the bridge and potentially being very dangerous in a lot of ways. We're actually going to move to a different place in the New Bohemia District. We'll check in with you just a little bit later at 9:30, also in Newbo, but all the way on the south end of the district to see if anything's different down there. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Kevin Barry, Fox 28 News.
We do have a lot of information to bring you tonight as people prepare for the high water in these final hours.
Right now, people in the flood-affected neighborhood in Cedar Rapids are under a curfew until 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. They were urged to evacuate by 8 o'clock tonight. Cedar Rapids schools are closed until Wednesday, and that's the latest information that may be updated. District leaders say they'll send parents some new information on Wednesday afternoon.
New tonight, Edgewood Road is now closed between Glass Road and Ellis Road Northwest. That includes the bridge across the river. Also, there are now 2 Red Cross shelters open in Cedar Rapids. One at Cedar Hills Community Church and the new one at St. Paul's United Methodist Church. You can find that information on our website, Fox28Iowa.com.
Right now, there are 3 sandbagging sites that are still open 24/7. Those sites are located at the Old Southwest Kmart, Hawkeye Downs, and Ellis Park Pavilion. We'll keep you updated on the flood efforts as new information comes in. And you can also download our CBS 2 and Fox 28 News app for free for Apple and Android users.
River levels are so crucial right now. Let's go to Chief Meteorologist Terry Swales for your weather first forecast. Terry.
And the crest is on the move. We've been watching this closely all day long. And now the Cedar River in Vinton is very near crest. It's expected tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. according to the hydrologists that we've been monitoring, at around 21.5 feet, but already the level is 21.28 feet. So it's just about 2 inches below what the projected crest is. So anytime tonight, it looks like it's going to reach that 21.5 foot level. And from there, it's going to continue moving downstream. And for most of the day now, the crest level in Cedar Rapids has been rock solid at 23 feet. So that is well above the flood stage, which is 12 foot. and we are expecting major flooding, the second highest crest ever here in Cedar Rapids. And you can see the river is on the move now. Our latest report is that it has risen to 15 feet. And it's going to go up a whole lot more here in the next 36 hours as it approaches that 23-foot crest. But you can see this is a wall of water and how quickly that water actually goes up. So it is on the move now in Cedar Rapids. Here is the main channel of the river right in here. And this is where the flooding at 23-foot encompasses. So there's a lot of places on either side of the river that will be underwater, including residential areas, perhaps as much as 1,000 homes impacted as the floodwaters move southeast. Also have a look here at Independence. The Wapsipinicon River there crested higher than expected in the Independence area, and it has actually crested now, is starting to drop a little bit. It should eventually head towards Anamosa, and the crest there is expected at 24.5 feet. So that is coming Wednesday morning, and major flooding is expected in the Anamosa area. And some new information, Rebecca?
The lower the crest in Anamosa to 24.1.
Okay, and that's just in here. So that's some good news in Anamosa. It's not a lot, but you'll take what you can get. So the crest now in Anamosa, 24.1 foot early on Wednesday morning. Guys?
Now going up the Cedar River from Cedar Rapids, Fox 28 meteorologist Jeff Kennedy is live in Vinton right now to show us what's happening there. Hi, Jeff.
Hi, Scott. Hi, Karen. Good evening. Thanks for having us on tonight with the folks in Vinton here dealing with some flood water tonight. We're kind of following the crest right on downstream. Last night, when we visited with you, we were in Cedar Falls. The crest happened there last night, happened in Waterloo as well last night. Tonight, the river continues to climb a little bit here in Benton County, and I'll step out of the way. We're in the Vinton Kirkwood Center parking lot, nice high and dry here. When we pulled in the lot this afternoon, there was no water here, so you can see this water has come up a lot. That Centennial Park, a celebration park, beg your pardon, on the other side of the street, the river's actually about a block and a half beyond where we are tonight, and continues to come up slowly. 21.3 is the latest number, and supposed to go to 21.5 here sometime overnight tonight or on into the early morning hours on Monday. And the thing is that this river's come up so fast here in Vinton, it's going to stay pretty high here for the next several days, guys. The forecast says it will remain above flood stage right on until about Thursday or so. Thankfully, our weather first forecast has no rain in it this week, which is great news. We really need some dry weather. But boy, right now, things continue to get kind of sloppy around here in Vinton, guys. That's it from Vinton. We're covering the corridor here in Benton County. I'm Jeff Kennedy for Fox 28 News.
Well, Jeff gave us a good look at Vinton, and you can see how that water is rising. It's now just over an hour past the curfew and evacuation time for those living along the river in downtown Cedar Rapids. Those evacuations, again, are not mandatory, but city leaders are urging residents to heed this warning. Fox 28 News anchor Janae Ryan joins us live after spending some time in the evacuation zone. Janae?
Yeah, Karen, right now the streets are empty. The neighborhood is quiet, but earlier today it was bustling with last minute preparations, trying to save each and every one of these homes from the coming floodwaters. This home in particular, it saw a lot of help. Look at all these sandbags. Now, if this home survives the flood, which everyone hopes it does, it's because of complete strangers. They had over 100 volunteers here today helping out sandbagging. They had dozens of trucks come by with loads of unexpected but very needed sandbags to help around the house. Volunteers came as far as Olwine to help these people that they didn't know. And there was also food and water delivered all day.
It really makes you look at what you have, especially around you and the wonderful people that are always, always there to help you no matter what. No matter what bad is in this world, there's always good that comes with it.
Now, Urlacher wants to say thank you from her heart to each and every volunteer that came out today to help save her house. She says that all of those people are now a member of her family in her heart. Again, the evacuations in this area are voluntary, but they are highly recommended, and there is a curfew in place till about 7 o'clock this coming morning. Officers, I've seen them, are patrolling to make sure there's no one wandering about that shouldn't be here. And if you do need to come back to your home for any reason, make sure you have your ID to verify that you do live here. Covering the corridor live in Cedar Rapids, Janae Ryan, Fox 28 News.
As people evacuate their homes, the Red Cross is giving them two places to go. We're going to check in with Fox 28 News reporter Dora Miller, who joins us live from one of the two shelters in Cedar Rapids. Dora?
We're at Cedar Hills Community Church, where this is far away from home for many people. But as you can see behind me, they're trying to make it as comfortable as possible. The Red Cross has set up cots and they have blankets just so that people have a place to lay their head at night in all of this uncertainty dealing with the flood. As far as kids go, there's tons of food and games for everybody. But there are some things that you should probably know before you come here if you're looking for shelter from the flood, especially in these times. For though right now I have with me Kara. She is from the Red Cross. So tell me a little bit about what people can expect when they are coming here.
So when you come to the emergency shelter, we're going to register. We're going to make sure we know who's with you, who's in your family, all of that. You want to make sure that if you have any prescriptions or medications, you bring those with you. If you have any special dietary needs, think about if you have infants or elderly people, any kind of special needs or special requirements that they might have, that you try to bring those with you.
So I understand that there are quite a few people in these shelters right now. Just how many are you guys housing?
So we have approximately 80 people in both the shelters here at Cedar Hills Community Church and also St. Paul's United Methodist over on the southeast side. And we have plenty of capacity, hundreds of people. We have another shelter on standby if we need it. And, you know, we'll get more if it's necessary.
Absolutely. I think that's such great news. Thank you guys for what you do. We will be here throughout the night and we'll continue to keep you updated, especially on the conditions of the floodwaters. But for right now, we'll send it back to you guys in the studio.
Thank you, Dora. With the major flooding expected in parts of Cedar Rapids and beyond, help is coming from the Iowa National Guard. Fox 28 News anchor Matt Hamill joins us live from the Nuevo District with the latest information on that. Matt?
Karen, I don't think I have ever been in Nuevo when it was this eerily quiet, when you could walk down the middle of 3rd Street, essentially all the way to the downtown. It is completely a ghost town. Of course, that makes people a little nervous about leaving their homes and businesses. But tomorrow at this time, there will be 400 National Guard troops here to help out. Now today, scores of volunteers turned out again in Nuevo to help fill sandbags and then take those bags to protect homes and businesses all over the city. But by tomorrow, a lot of those volunteers are heading back to work, heading back to school. That's when the Guard will step in, especially in areas where the water is rising fast.
Part of that mission will be working at the evacuation control points, which is to kind of help things moving smoothly for people that need to evacuate certain areas. They'll be on the ground and ready to do the mission sometime early tomorrow afternoon.
Colonel Hapgood says that they are also bringing some special equipment with them to help during major flooding. We'll talk more about that coming up at 9:30. For now, covering the corridor in Nuevo, Matt Hamill, Fox 28 News.
Still to come on the Fox 28 News at 9, Cedar Rapids Mayor Ron Corbett will join us live in the studio. We will get his take on what the city wants people to know right now.
Now let's take a live look outside at Nuevo, 3rd Street. What Matt said is so true, eerily quiet at this hour on a Sunday night. We'll show you many more pictures throughout our coverage. In the meantime, let's talk to Terry one more time.
And when we come back, we're going to take a look at some other historic crests here in the Cedar Rapids area and around eastern Iowa for that matter. And we'll also see where the river stands now and where it's going to end up in the next 24 to 48 hours as the flood of 2016 continues here in eastern Iowa.
There are similarities between this flood and the one in 2008, but actually it's quite unique unto itself.
Meteorologist Rebecca Kopelman is here now with some more perspective on this.
Yeah, we've been talking about perspective and putting it into line with all of the history that we do have along this river. And with 165 years of records here in Cedar Rapids, to break this down, we've had many crests, and taking the top 30, many of them occur in the spring and summer. 13 occurred between the months of March and April, which were snowmelt crests, meaning that due to all the snow that fell and all of it melting coming on down the river basin, that led to high river levels. Then we go through May to August, which typically has to do with heavy rain events, and that is the largest amount there of 17 of those occurrences. And now this one in September will be the first crest, not just in the top 30, but ever recorded in history in the last 165 years, dating back to 1851, that this has occurred in the month of September during the fall. And we have many reasons for this. It's mainly been due to all this late rainfall that we've had in the later part of our rainy season here in eastern Iowa, mainly in the northern part of the state. So it will be the first time this has occurred in the month of September. And now, Chief Meteorologist Terry Swales has more historical perspective with other really just historical events that have occurred along this river.
Yeah, thanks, Rebecca. We did a little bit of digging here, and in the archives, we came up with some old pictures of some floods here in the Cedar Rapids area. And this picture was taken at Riverside Park just at the turn of the century in 1900. And of course, they didn't have cars then, but they certainly had bicycles and horses. So you can see some of the people down by the river looking at the flooding there. And another scene actually was taken here on 12th Avenue and 3rd Street in 1929. And you can see they had troubles with businesses being flooded back in those days. But at least by then, they did have some cars. And another shot here is taken in 1961. And this is Highway 218 in Cedar Falls. And you can see the massive flooding there and what it did to 218. It pretty much just tore the road out. So we've been dealing with floods as long as we can remember here in eastern Iowa, but not many of them reach the magnitude that this one is going to over the next several days. And in fact, next in line here is Vinton, and the river is just about to crest there any time. It's already up to 21.28 inches, and the projected crest is actually tomorrow morning at 21.5 feet, so it's just about there. And that is where our Jeff Kennedy is located tonight. You got your flood boots on, Jeff? What's going on out there tonight?
Yeah, Terry, well, I know your wife grew up here and my wife grew up here, so we're both familiar with Vinton and Benton County. When we got here tonight or earlier this afternoon, the parking lot that we're in right now is the Kirkwood Vinton Center, and this was dry. All this pavement was dry. There was no water here. That is Celebration Park on the other side of the street, and you can see the gazebo there is well in the middle of all that water. We had some kids riding their bikes through the water earlier on tonight, and it's a good 2 feet deep out there in the street. The river continues to come up a little bit at a time. As you said, Terry, it's 21.3 right now. It's supposed to go to 21.5, so we'll kind of keep an eye on that here through the overnight hours. And I'm really glad that the weather first forecast has no rain in it for this week, because we really need some dry weather here and maybe a little bit of fall weather from what I hear. Is that right?
We'll definitely be seeing some cooler temperatures, Jeff. I promise you that much. And even better, there is no rain in the long range forecast all the way through the rest of the week. So let's get back down to Cedar Rapids now and show you what the river is expected to do here. And by Tuesday morning, we think right around 23 feet is where the river should crest here. We've been holding steady on that most of the day here. So that's major flooding, the second highest crest ever in the Cedar Rapids area. And only one other time have we gone above 20 feet, and that was back in 2008. And you can see we are in the throes of it now. The river is really taking off and rising fast. This is what's known as a hydrograph here. And you can see what the river is expected to do over a 7 day period. We're now up to about 15 foot. And over the next, oh, say 24 hours, we're going to get very close to that 21 foot level and then eventually crest Tuesday morning at around 23 feet. And then gradually the river does start to tail off. And by the time we get to next weekend, we should be back down to about flood stage. And here's the other thing that we really hate to see with the river running right through here at that 23 foot mark. It really starts to spread out and covers a lot of the area, especially residential areas on the west side of the river and some of the businesses in downtown. And there's also residential areas to the southeast there that also be impacted. So things are going to get really ugly, and it's going to be very difficult to commute around Cedar Rapids because a lot of roads will be closed as well. And the way we see it now, it looks like we're in for about 6.5 days where the river will be above flood stage here in Cedar Rapids. The worst of it, though, is going to be these 54 hours where the river is expected to be above 20 feet. And this is over in Independence, where we've had more flooding today. The Wapsipinicon River up there has really gone crazy. It has actually crested in Independence, but now the river is moving downstream. And in Anamosa, you're expecting a crest there Wednesday morning of around 24.1 feet, and that would be the second highest level in Anamosa's history. And here's the radar tonight, and while there are a few sprinkles around to the east of us, this front is now making progress, and as it has moved off to the east of us, it has taken the threat of any rain with it. And for the next several days, this is our rainfall forecast all the way through the weekend, only 2/100 of an inch here expected in Cedar Rapids. So that's the best news I can offer you tonight. You can also see how the skies have cleared out to the west of us. So as we deal with the floods over the next few days, at least our skies will be nice and sunny. So your forecast for tonight does call for lows upper 40s to lower 50s. We'll see gradual clearing in our skies. Then for tomorrow, it's back to mostly sunny skies, but a very fresh day. Look at the temperatures all around eastern Iowa. They will be holding in the 60s. And your extended forecast here has plenty of sunshine, as I promised you, right on through the upcoming weekend. Temperatures start out pretty cool and then eventually get back to more seasonal levels with highs this weekend right back up there around 70 degrees.
Coming up on Fox 28 News at 9, we're going to give you some new information. For example, as you take a live look here at the Cedar River in Vinton, the Ellis Park sandbagging staging area in Cedar Rapids is now closed. So we have two open, but the one at Ellis Park is now closed. Again, a live look at the rising cedar in Vinton, nearing its crest as we speak. We're going to talk with Cedar Rapids Mayor Ron Corbett when we come right back.
Listen throughout the day for your weather first forecast on the mighty 1630 KCJJ.
I'm joined now by Cedar Rapids Mayor Ron Corbett, a gentleman who hasn't had much sleep over the last several days, like many of us here in Cedar Rapids. I wanted to talk about the voluntary evacuations that are underway right now. People were supposed to have evacuated by 8 o'clock tonight. Why is it important for people to heed the voluntary evacuation request?
Well, it's important from a safety standpoint, their personal safety, but also potentially putting at risk firefighters and emergency rescue personnel in the event that they would have to rescue someone. So if you're watching this at home right now and you're sitting in your living room in the inundated area, you know, I plead with you to go grab your suitcase or your duffel bag, put some clothes in it, some medication, maybe some toiletries, and please just move out. It's only for a short period of time through today, and we think we can get everybody at least have access to their place on Saturday. Please do this. We've built this levee system to prevent flooding on all both sides of the river, and we're working with the Corps of Engineers on that, but there's always the possibility these temporary systems, you know, could breach, and you know, that's our biggest concern right now. And so the rising water is one thing, but when you have a breach in a levee that's holding back, you know, 20 feet, 30 feet, or 23 feet of water, and there's a breach that comes gushing out, and that's a concern. And one of the reasons we ask people to, you know, please respect the evacuation order and move out.
Coupling the evacuation order is the curfew that is now in effect until 7 a.m. What's the purpose of the curfew, Mayor?
Well, a lot of people have posted a lot of pictures on social media about the flood protection system that's been built in the last 72 hours. It's an amazing effort by the workers and the community, but it's not a tourist site. It is a flood protection system, and we don't need people walking. We don't need people riding their bicycles and motorcycles or cars. This is not an area we want you to be in. So, you know, please, you know, respect that evacuation. We're doing it for a reason. For safety. So as tempting as it may be to want to come down and look at it, we ask you not to do that. And tomorrow when people are, you know, going to work, there will be some traffic challenges with only Wilson Avenue and 7th open. You know, it's tempting to drive on 380 and look over your shoulder at the river, and then you slow down. It's a difficult section of the road anyway, as it is, the S-curve. So please use caution in the morning, and because there will be more traffic on 380 than normally would because of the exit ramps that are closed.
We've been reporting on the National Guard that will be coming to Cedar Rapids, several hundred National Guard members, as well as state troopers, to assist in security. Is that what they're coming primarily for, is to secure the area, the perimeter around the evacuation?
Yeah, so the inundation area that we've designated as, you know, where the flooding would take place, we have checkpoints that we want to make sure that people aren't going in. The National Guard will serve that purpose. So they should be in place by noon tomorrow. We're meeting with the Corps of Engineers in the morning to discuss the levee system and any issues that there may be with that. We think it's in great shape. We're doing all the last minute inspections and work this evening, but there's always that possibility. So we bring in the Corps, their experts. It's been a great 72 hours, a great rally for the city. You know, now we have to deal, this is the dangerous part. And so if you live in that area, get out. And if you're not in that area, stay out.
You have worked in both the public and private sector. What are you hearing from the business community downtown right now as we near this crest?
Well, most of the business community made their preparations very quickly. They knew that this crest was going to come late Monday or Tuesday. They weren't sure. So most of them, by Friday, made plans to relocate this week. So the business community is doing that. They're relocating. We just want the homeowners out there that may be watching tonight that are still in their home and thinking this isn't going to be bad and I can stay here. Hopefully the first line of protection system works, but in the event of a breach, it could cause some big problems. And so safety is our number one concern right now.
Good luck as we move into the critical mass stage here.
Thank you.
Yes, Mayor Ron Corbett from Cedar Rapids. We want to give you a live look at the National Czech and Slovak Museum and Library as seen across the river from Newbo. We'll be right back.
Major flooding can overwhelm even the largest of cities, and that is why the Iowa National Guard has been ordered to Cedar Rapids to help. Fox 28 News reporter, anchor Matt Hamill joins us live from the Newbo District with more on the Guard's mission in Cedar Rapids and areas. Matt?
We're here in front of CSPS. Of course, Newbo, one of the evacuation areas around town, as you may be able to see above the Reagan building over here, those apartments completely dark. There is no neighborhood watch here tonight. But tomorrow afternoon, more than 400 Iowa Guard troops will arrive in Cedar Rapids. As volunteers return to work and school, the Guard will step in. I just talked to Colonel Greg Hapgood a short time ago. He says as the water rises, they are equipped not only to help with security, but with high clearance vehicles that can move people and supplies through floodwaters if it's needed.
Our job is to anticipate where it is we're going to be needed, kinds of tasks that we might be asked to do, and to make sure that we've got people that are kind of warm, if you will, that are ready to go when we need them at a moment's notice.
Colonel Hapgood says after 175 years of fighting floods in Iowa, they have a lot of experience. He says those 400 Guard troops will step in wherever the city needs them. Covering the corridor tonight in Newbo, Matt Hamill, Fox 28 News.
Local first responders are now stationed on both sides of the river. Crews say there are police and firefighters ready with boats and specialty equipment. Since all bridges are closed, I-380 will be the only way for first responders to get to emergency calls. And some 380 exits are closed for emergency and construction crews only. So, if you're driving along 380, they're asking people to be patient and allow more travel time.
That's what we're here for. We're here to help people. And we have a mission to not only respond to the flood event, but to help our citizenry that aren't directly impacted in the flood evacuation zone as well.
Greg Bulow says there was a designated emergency car lane on I-380 during the flood back in 2008. Right now, there isn't one, but city officials say they will make plans if needed.
We will be right back with the Fox 28 News at 9. And as we go to commercial break, we want to show you another picture of the Cedar River in Vinton, where it's getting very close to the crest of 21.5. We'll be right back.
Right now, the Cedar River in Cedar Rapids is over flood stage. And what you're looking at now is a live picture of the Newbo District along the river, an area that really grew out of the last flood in 2008. A resurgence in this area resulted in new restaurants and new arts and entrepreneurial communities. It's really an amazing effort, but as you can see tonight, it's as quiet as I've ever seen it. We are efforting as much information as we can for you as we approach critical mass along the Cedar River and Cedar Rapids.
Right now, people in the affected neighborhoods in Cedar Rapids, as you know, are under a curfew until 7 in the morning. Residents in that area have been asked to leave by 8 o'clock tonight, so hopefully they have heeded that warning. Cedar Rapids School District closed until Wednesday, and district leaders say that may change, so they'll be sending parents more information on Wednesday afternoon.
New tonight, as we mentioned, Edgewood Road is now closed between Ellis and Glass Roads. That includes the Edgewood Road Bridge across the Cedar. Also, there are now two Red Cross shelters open in Cedar Rapids, one at Cedar Hills Community Church. That was the original location. Now they have a new one at St. Paul's United Methodist Church. You can find that information on our website, cbs2iowa.com.
And right now, two sandbagging sites remain open 24/7. Those sites are located at the old Southwest Kmart and Hawkeye Downs. The Ellis Park Pavilion is now closed. We'll keep bringing you the latest information as we learn it. You can also download our free app on Android or Apple.
As Cedar Rapids braces for the worst flooding in nearly a decade, workers have built a wall shielding the downtown from water with millions of pounds of sand. City officials say the courthouse and jail on Mays Island and nearby City Hall are surrounded by $100,000 worth of HESCO barriers. Linn County Supervisor Jim Hauser says the downtown can handle the water so long as the river's crest is below 28 feet.
We are tracking how the Cedar River is affecting downtown Cedar Rapids. Fox 28 News anchor Kevin Berry is now in a different part of the New Bohemia District at a controversial demarcation line on 16th Avenue. Tell us about it, Kevin.
Karen, we are right on the corner of that demarcation line on 16th Avenue. If you look over my right shoulder right here, that is the Lion Bridge that goes over to the Czech Village. The Czech and Slovak Museum is right behind me. That's just over my left shoulder. And this line of demarcation here settles the dry part, which is over on that area that you see now, from the part that if water were to come over the riverbanks, that would be the wet part. And right behind the camera's view are some businesses that are affected by that. Right now, though, we can take a look right across the river at the Czech and Slovak Museum. That's where the water is running underneath, and you see just about how high it is coming up to the riverbanks. There's HESCO barriers right in front of the Czech and Slovak Museum, and obviously the Czech and Slovak Museum is up a lot higher than it was back in 2008 now because of that flood. It was moved and shifted upwards. But that's kind of just one of the best views that we have tonight, at least, of exactly how high that water is getting. Coming up in just a little bit, probably about 15 to 20, maybe 30 minutes, we're going to move to one of the more controversial parts of this wall. It's just a little bit over that way where there are pumps that are going to be taking the water from the dry side if it gets in and pumping it very close to some businesses that are on the other side of the wall. We'll take a firsthand look at where those pumps are and exactly the work that they'll be doing. That's coming up just a little bit later on in this extended version of the Fox 28 News at 9. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Kevin Barry, Fox 28 News.
We've been talking about the curfew and evacuations that are now in effect along the Cedar River and Cedar Rapids. Fox 28 News anchor Janae Ryan joins us live once again from the evacuation zone. So, Janae, what's going on there?
Well, Scott, right now it's dark, it's quiet, no one is outside, and that's because I'm on 13th Street and H Avenue Northwest. I'm on the very edge of the evacuation flood zone, and lots of these streets are closed, as you can see right here. And when I came out to this neighborhood, I've been here all day deep into the evacuation zone on the edge. I expected to see some chaos and some panicking. I mean, these floods are going to put these houses at risk, but that's not what I saw. What I saw was kindness and compassion and selflessness and teamwork, all in the form of some hard, heavy lifting and some sandbags. There were volunteers all over this town helping each other. This home that you're seeing right now is on the edge of the current evacuation area near where I'm at. And the Roots program actually just finished building this home about a year ago, replacing the home that was there and destroyed back in the 2008 floods. So the owner, who's currently recovering actually from two broken ribs, is definitely crossing her fingers that her brand new home survives this flood unscathed. And if it does, It's thanks to the helpful strangers who came by with all these sandbags, who she now calls her heroes. And of course, she also had help from her sons.
I'm far out of it, so I can lend a hand, and just like the people driving around, you know, it's what people got to do. It makes the world a better place when people are like that. So.
Awesome. Anything else you want to say that we haven't covered?
No, stay dry, guys.
And he says, stay strong to everyone here. And they all want to thank everyone that came out to help his mom with her sandbags there. Everyone who gave sandbags to everyone else. Someone celebrating with some fireworks here. And also these evacuations, like Scott said, are voluntary but highly recommended. And there is a curfew. I've seen the officers patrolling the area. So if you do need to come in for anything, if you have evacuated, just have your ID to show them that you do live here and they'll let you in. Covering the corridor live in Cedar Rapids, Janae Ryan, Fox 28 News.
As similar as this flood is to the one in 2008, it's actually pretty unique for this state.
Yeah, let's go to meteorologist Rebecca Kopelman.
Well, we talked yesterday about all the history along the Cedar River, and we have records that go back 165 years. And yesterday we talked about that this would be the second time the Cedar River and Cedar Rapids would cross the 20-foot mark. But this would actually be the first time that the Cedar River would crest above flood stage in the month of September. All these records dating back to 1851 show that most of these crests typically occur in the summer months from May to August, and that is typically due to heavy rainfall events, and that tacks up to 17 in the last 30 crests. Now, snowmelt crests also are a factor here. When we see a rise in the river during the months of March and April, the top 30 crests, we've had about 13 of those occur in those 2 months. However, this is a unique event because this time it occurred in September, and it has never happened in the last 165 years that the Cedar River has crested above flood stage in this month. So it is going to be an historic event, and as we've mentioned, it will be the second time that it will cross the 20-foot mark. And Chief Meteorologist Terry Swales is here with all the latest crest information.
Thank you, Rebecca. Very interesting stuff. And as you can see here with our latest crest information out of Vinton, the river continues to slowly inch up. It's nearly 21.4 feet, just under the projected crest of 21.5, which is pegged at 7 a.m. Monday morning. So you are really close to the crest up there in Vinton, and hopefully it does not go any higher than 21.5 feet. Now, downstream in Cedar Rapids, we still have a little time to get the crest in here, but it is starting to rise now rapidly, the river that is, and our crest should be at 23 feet, and that's expected sometime around 7 a.m. on Tuesday morning, the second highest level ever in the history of the river here in Cedar Rapids. And on our hydrograph here, you can clearly see what's happening. This is where the river was very early this morning. Now it's starting to take off, and eventually it'll continue to rise and reach that 23-foot level. We're expecting a jump of about 10 feet in the next 36 hours as that massive wall of water continues to work its way on to the south. And we think by the time this is over with, we're going to have about 6.5 days where the river is above flood stage here in Cedar Rapids. The worst of it in this period right in here, but I think about 54 hours, at least according to the hydrograph, where the river should be at 20 feet or above. So that'll be a big, big mess. And traveling will be very difficult around Cedar Rapids, especially in the downtown area. And earlier today, this picture was taken in Independence, where the Wapsipinicon River was really roaring out of its banks there. The river has now crested in Independence, but it is moving on down to the southeast. The crest, that is, and it should be in the Anamosa area at about 24.1 feet, and that does not come until Wednesday morning. So major flooding is anticipated there, the second highest crest ever recorded in Anamosa. Here's the radar tonight. A few very light showers in far eastern Iowa, really not much more than sprinkles. A front has now moved on through. You can really tell it out there tonight. It's breezy and it's cool. And with that front to the east of us and high pressure dominating the weather, our rainfall forecast, which goes all the way out through Saturday, does not show any additional rain in Iowa or virtually all of the upper Midwest. So we're entering a nice dry period as we go through the next several days. And you can also see out to the west of us, the skies have cleared. So this sunshine will be back in our skies tomorrow, but it is going to be a cool day here in eastern Iowa. Tonight's forecast actually calling for lows in the 40s all the way down to around Cedar Rapids. We'll go 47 in Waterloo and about 49 degrees in Dubuque. I think Charles City will be one of the cooler places, maybe 47 down in Waterloo too. So it will get a little chilly out there, especially with those winds at 10 to 15. Then for tomorrow, a very cool morning, but eventually we'll get temperatures back up into the 60s. But this will be one of the chilliest days of the fall so far. But at least there will be some sunshine in our skies, but it will be a bit breezy out there. Those west winds be in the range of about 15 to 30 miles an hour. And here is the extended forecast. And it has been quite a while since I can say that we would have a 7-day stretch without any rainfall, but that's the way it's looking now all the way through Sunday. We are anticipating dry conditions, and temperatures will go from about 65 on Monday to about 71 on Saturday before dropping just a little bit on Sunday back to 70 degrees. Much better weather in our future, Karen.
Thank you for that, Terry. Coming up on the Fox 28 News at 9, we're going to show you another live picture. This is out around Newbo, where pumps are stationed there over the wall. Coming up, find out why some business owners feel left out because of these pumps, and even worse, we'll explain.
One of Cedar Rapids' most iconic buildings got a lot of help preparing for the flood. Cedar Rapids Carpenters Union Local 308 showed up at the Paramount Theater today with power tools to take apart the nearly 100 seats on the first level. Then a small army of volunteers streamed in to carry those chairs to higher ground. Local 308 says they take pride in what they've helped build.
Yeah, absolutely. This is our community. We were devastated after the 2008 flood, so we wanted to take pride in our community and help out wherever we can.
Local 308 has been teaming up over the past few days to help not only the Paramount, but family members and anyone else packing up and saving their homes and possessions before the flooding starts.
Well, another well-known stop downtown is completely bare inside. Take a look. This is, used to be, Parlor City. They took all their tables and seating out to keep it all dry if they should take on any water. The owners say they did lose a lot that could have been removed in 2008. So this time, they are not taking any chances.
If you or someone you know is looking for a place to stay after being evacuated, the Red Cross now has two shelters set up and running in Cedar Rapids. Fox 28 News reporter Dora Miller is at one of the churches welcoming residents. Dora?
Well, Scott, this is not easy for families who are going through this. I mean, this is not an ideal place for them to live. Take a look at just some of the living quarters that we have here. This is a bed setup, and it's as comfortable as you can make it without it being your home. But we are at Cedar Hills Community Church, where they're trying their best to make it as homely as they can. And I'm with Crystal here. Crystal has not ever had to evacuate due to a flood, but this is her first time. Crystal, tell me a little bit about what's going through your mind.
Well, it's a little scary, but I've been in worse situations, and I was here in 2008, so I know that everybody will pull through, and Cedar Rapids will definitely pull through.
What does it mean to kind of have so much help behind you, not only community members, but organizations like Red Cross coming in?
It means a lot, because otherwise we would have absolutely nowhere to go. We would be in our car pretty much, so it means the world to, I'm sure I'm not the only one that's in the same situation.
Absolutely. And there's no shortage of fun activities here. I know you have kids, so tell me a little bit about how they've been handling this situation.
Well, they just like to play with the other kids, so we kind of just all adapt together, and that's just how it works.
It's a big family, it feels like.
Yeah, definitely a big family.
Absolutely. Thank you, Crystal. We appreciate it. Well, we'll be here throughout the night, and we will continue to update you on some of the things you need to know if you are looking to evacuate and need to get to a shelter. But for now, we'll take it back to you guys in the studio.
Thank you, Dora. Capri College is now offering its facility to licensed stylist professionals who were displaced during the flood. So if you want to continue serving your clients during this time, you are invited to use space at Capri College, and you can do it for free. Cosmetologists, massage therapists, and any other professional stylists will have a home with salon chairs, wax rooms, and private massage areas. That's at Capri. The only request they have is that you are a licensed professional.
We will do whatever we can to make sure that everyone has a place to meet their clients and see their clients, because sometimes just seeing our favorite ladies that come in every week puts a smile on our face.
Capri College says it will stay open as long as stylists need the space. Both locations in Cedar Rapids and Waterloo will start accepting stylists immediately.
Going to be another day or so before the Cedar River Crest in Cedar Rapids, but right now it is so close to the crest in Vinton. That's what you're looking at live right now, the Cedar River in Vinton. Right now at 21.3 feet, the crest is 21.5. And as you look live here, we want to make you aware that all public sandbagging locations in Cedar Rapids have now closed. All of the sandbagging locations in Cedar Rapids now closed. Flood 2016 coverage continues on Fox 28 News. Next. Fox 28 News anchor Kevin Berry has been all over this city over the last 3 days, and right now he's back in Newbo on a very controversial demarcation line. Kevin, bring us up to speed on this.
Yeah, Scott, so these are two pipes and two kind of hoses that take water over the top of this barricade. So now we are on the dry side of what this line of demarcation is supposed to be. These are the HESCO barriers that if the water breaches the Cedar River banks down by 16th Avenue, so we're right by like Little Bohemia, the bar, Kickstand, we're right across the street from. If the water gets into that area, these hoses will pump it from the dry side and bring it over the top to the wet side. So you follow this hose down. This is a big pump. There's another pump over there that has a city sticker on it. I haven't seen any city stickers on this one, but this is one of the pumps, and you see it run all the way into the sewer. So if the sewer starts backing up, this is how they get the water out from the side that they want to stay dry and put on the wet side. If you happen to catch the Fox 28 News at 9 or the CBS News at 10 yesterday, or this was a story that was blowing up all over Facebook, the problem is on the other side of that wall are a bunch of businesses. There's about four or five buildings. And if we take a look over here, right next to those drainage pipes, let's walk all the way over even. Jason, I'll help you over this. Yep, there you go, perfect. You see Kickstand, that's their sign right there. And so not only is there Kickstand, but then there's other buildings down that way. We spoke with the owners of Tornadoes all the way down just catty corner to where Little Bohemia is. They're on the wrong side or the wet side of this HESCO barrier. And the owner of Tornadoes is extremely angry about that. He says, we're a part of the district. Why don't we get protection? Well, we went out and asked the city, and the Public Works Director, Jen Winter, told us that the reason the HESCO barrier is right here is because this is the last highest point and the last most concrete and flat point that they can put the HESCO barriers on, and that's how the HESCO barriers work most effectively. So therefore, that's where the HESCO barriers go. They say there's a lot to protect in the Newbo District, and they can't compromise their one line of defense in order to make sure they can't compromise the one line of defense into the Newbo District just to try to include some places that would be too hard to protect because of the topography or the type of land that it would sit on. It's been very controversial. We know that the owner of Tornadoes is very much against this plan. I did happen to speak to one of the other business owners who owns property on that end, and he sees the other side of this. He actually sides with the city. He says, I've invested a lot of money there, and I'm okay with it being the way it is. He's like, this is how it has to be. It is worth noting he also has invested a lot of money on this side of the wall as well that he wants to be protected. So we're going to be following a lot of this story in the next coming days. Obviously, this all depends on how the water comes up. If the water doesn't damage anybody, it's all for naught. But if the water does come over and potentially hurt somebody, it's a problem. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Kevin Berry, Fox 28 News.
All right, Kevin, thank you. And this is a picture that you've seen in Vinton. And if you look at the bottom of your screen, you can see the markings of a parking lot. There is the Celebration, I believe it is, park there across the way that has water coming up almost to the little fence around the gazebo. And you can see from the streetlights reflecting that it is covered with water. We understand that Vinton is very close to cresting as well, so we'll keep watching that for you.
We're not going to leave the air. We're going to continue coverage on Fox 28 and CBS 2 right after the break.
In the meantime, we've just gotten some new information in from Terry. There is a crest update that he will be telling us about. It apparently has not changed. It's staying at 23, so we'll be going to Terry just shortly here.
Also today, the CBS 2 Fox 28 drone captured exclusive aerial footage of Cedar Rapids as the city entered the flood stage. The drone captured a look at the bridges as the water rose and different parts of the downtown area. We will continue to bring you CBS 2 Fox 28 exclusive footage like this while the flood waters threaten Cedar Rapids. We do have a lot of information to bring you tonight as people prepare for the high water in these final hours.
Right now, people in the flood-affected neighborhood in Cedar Rapids are under a curfew. 7 o'clock tomorrow morning, they were urged to evacuate by 8 o'clock tonight. Cedar Rapids School District has closed schools until Wednesday. That could be updated, so district leaders say they will let parents know with some information released on Wednesday afternoon.
New tonight, you can no longer get over the Cedar River by way of the Edgewood Road Bridge. Edgewood Road is closed now between Glass Road and Ellis Road Northwest. That includes the bridge. Also, there are now 2 Red Cross shelters open in Cedar Rapids for those who have to be evacuated or if you need a place to stay. One is at Cedar Hills Community Church. The other is at St. Paul's United Methodist Church. You can find all of that information on our website, cbs2iowa.com.
And this just in, right now, there are no longer any sandbagging sites open. Some had been open 24/7 at the Southwest Kmart, the Hawkeye Downs, Ellis Park Pavilion. All 3 of those are now closed down. We'll keep you updated on the flood efforts if any new information comes in. But you can always download our CBS 2 News app for free on your Apple or Android device.
Chief Meteorologist Terry Swells is joining us now because I guess we're going to get or have gotten some new information.
Yes, we do have some new information in Vinton and in Cedar Rapids. And we're also going to make some comparisons between this flood and 2008. We've got a really interesting graphic on that. So after we go to a break, that's what's coming our way.
Okay.
All right.
Going up the Cedar River from Cedar Rapids, Fox 28 meteorologist Jeff Kennedy is live in Vinton right now to show us what is happening there. Jeff?
Yeah, hi, Scott. Hi, Karen. Good evening from Vinton and Benton County, where the water continues to come up just a little at a time. We've been kind of tracking it through the parking lot here this afternoon. I'll step out of the shot here so Scott can show you all of the shiny water that you're looking at. That's Celebration Park on the other side of the street, where the grills are in the water, the picnic tables are in the water, the gazebo is surrounded by flood water, and the lot that we're in is Kirkwood's Vinton Center in downtown Vinton, if you're familiar with the city of Vinton. When we got here this afternoon about 3 o'clock, the lot was dry, and now it's probably half or so underwater. So the river has risen that much in just a few hours. 21.4, I heard Terry say just a couple minutes ago, and the forecast crest is 21.5. So we're essentially at the crest now, or near the crest, as we speak. The forecast is supposed to, the crest is supposed to occur early Monday morning at around 7 or 8 a.m. So we'll continue to monitor things here in Vinton. If you're familiar with the city of Vinton, a lot of streets near the river go up and down, kind of hilly, and it's a little difficult to negotiate some of these roads in Vinton. They're either blocked off or covered with water, and some of the streets that were not covered with water earlier on today, like this one you're seeing now, for example, are under at least several inches of water. So I think we'll be dealing with some of these kind of topsy-turvy conditions here in Vinton, guys, for the next few days. The forecast says that the river here will remain at or above flood stage right on into Thursday. That's it from Vinton. We're covering the corridor live in Vinton tonight. I'm Jeff Kennedy for Fox 28 News.
All right, Jeff, we appreciate that. We'll be going to Terry about Vinton in a little bit. Right now, though, it's just over 2 hours past the curfew in Cedar Rapids and evacuation time for those living along the river. Those evacuations are not mandatory, but city leaders did urge residents to heed that warning. Fox 28 News anchor Janae Ryan joins us live after spending some time today in the evacuation zone. Janae?
Yeah, Karen, right now it's dark, it's quiet, there is not much going on here in these neighborhoods near downtown Cedar Rapids, but earlier today they were bustling because there were people coming to help save each and one of these homes in the evacuation area. You can see lots of the streets are closed right now. There were hundreds of volunteers out helping, and one home in particular we're about to show you right now, it is owned by the Urlachers, and they tell me that they had near 100 volunteers, people they've never met before, come by today and help sandbag their home. Now they are very close to the river. There were also dozens of cars that came by with full of sandbags that were not expected, but very much so needed. And they also came with water and food to feed the volunteers.
It really makes you look at what you have, especially around you and the wonderful people that are always, always there to help you no matter what. No matter what bad is in this world, there's always good that comes with it.
And Urlacher wants to thank each and every volunteer from the bottom of her heart. She says thank you for helping her save her home. And we all sure hope that her home is saved as everyone else's is. Again, that evacuation order is voluntary, not mandatory, but it is very much so recommended. And there is a curfew right now. And I've seen some officers patrolling the area. If you do live here and you do need to come back to your home for something, make sure you have your ID to prove that you have a right to be here and you need to be here. If you haven't evacuated yet, some reminders, make sure you grab a bag of clothes and toiletries maybe that you need, also your ID and any medications, and make sure to grab your pets. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Janae Ryan, Fox 28 News.
As people evacuate, the Red Cross is giving them a place to go. Fox 28 News reporter Dora Miller is joining us live from one of two shelters open in Cedar Rapids tonight. Dora?
That's right, Scott. We are still hanging out at the Cedar Hills Community Church, where it's been lights out now for maybe about 5 or 6 minutes. So things are starting to quiet down quite a bit here. But as you can see, it's pretty bare here now. But there are some rules that need to be followed while you're here in the shelter. And I have here with me Kara from the Red Cross, who has been kind of coordinating a lot of these things. Tell me a little bit about what people can expect when they come here.
So when you arrive at a Red Cross shelter, you want to make sure that you bring medication, prescriptions, things like that, that you might need for the next 7 days or for however long you may need to stay in the shelter. You want to make sure that you have anything for any little kids that you might have with you, or if you have any folks who are elderly with you that might have any special needs. But we'll register. We'll get you a cot, a blanket, a pillow. We'll have 3 meals a day, and we're here for folks as they need us.
Absolutely. And I understand that there are a lot of people that are going to be impacted by this flood and that are taking the proper precautions. Do you have a limit to how many people that you guys can serve?
No, we're prepared to handle whatever comes our way. So we've got the two shelters in place at St. Paul's United Methodist, and then here at Cedar Hills Community Church. We've got another shelter on standby if the need arises, and we can always look for others if we need to.
Absolutely. I think it's amazing what you guys are doing, and you can tell by the attitude here that people are really receptive and they're really happy about this kind of help that they're getting. So thank you.
Thank you. American Red Cross volunteers are incredibly generous people, and we're just lucky to have them here.
Absolutely. Well, we will be here as well with the Red Cross volunteers. We'll be hanging out here just making sure that everything is cool. And if you do have questions, we're here to answer those within our next newscast as well. But we'll be here in Cedar Rapids. Back to you guys in the studio.
All right, Dora, thank you. That is a place that we'll probably see a lot more action in the coming days as the Cedar River crests and families are dislocated. So we'll keep checking in with Dora. With the major flooding expected in parts of Cedar Rapids and beyond, help is coming from the Iowa National Guard en masse. Fox 28 News anchor Matt Hamill joins us now from the Newbo District with the latest information on that. Matt?
Guys, an absolute ghost town here in Newbo tonight is one of the evacuation areas. How often can you walk down the middle of 3rd Street and not have to worry about traffic at all? And it's that way all the way to the downtown, enough to make people a little bit nervous about leaving their homes and businesses behind. But tomorrow, there will be 400 National Guard troops on these streets. Now today, there were still scores of volunteers that turned out again in Newbo to help fill sandbags and then take those bags to protect homes and businesses all over the city. But by tomorrow, a lot of those volunteers are heading back to work and to school. And that's when the Guard will step in, especially in areas where the water is rising fast.
Part of that mission will be working at the evacuation control points, which is to kind of help things moving smoothly for people that need to evacuate certain areas. They'll be on the ground and ready to do the mission sometime early tomorrow afternoon.
Colonel Hapgood says that the Guard will also bring in special equipment. They will have vehicles that can drive through very deep water if they are needed for either rescues or evacuations. Of course, everybody hoping that everyone gets out and that isn't necessary. Covering the corridor tonight in Cedar Rapids, in Newbo, Matt Hamill, Fox 28 News.
We are kind of double teaming Newbo tonight because, you know, that area actually grew right out of the flood of 2008. Let's go to Kevin Berry live in a different part of Newbo tonight. Kevin, what's up there?
Yes, Scott, you see us taking a look at the White Elephant building. This is a building that was an old consignment shop in the New Bohemia district. It's right next to Beta's, if anybody knows where that is. But we talked to the owner of this property. This obviously used to be over on 3rd Street, rather, and it got moved over here. But now it's in danger of being flooded out because you see it's up on these trusses here. And if the water comes into here, it's in an incredibly precarious position where it's just bolted to the ground. But if the water is too strong, it's a very real possibility it could be toppled over. And that would just be tragic for the owners if that were to happen, not only for the financial benefit, but also for the historical significance. It's one of the oldest buildings that was in Cedar Rapids, and they're trying their hardest just to try to get it back up, and they're going to eventually try to park it over there. We're following this story. We're also following some of the stories about some of those businesses on the other side. We're going to check on them before our next hit, and we'll bring that to you as soon as we can. We're covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids. Kevin Barry, Fox 28 News.
Thank you, Kevin. Here is one of the places where many of the evacuees can go. This is Cedar Hills Community Church, one of the two Red Cross shelters open in Cedar Rapids right now.
And now let's go to Terry for another look at what's happening out there.
Well, we're going to show you a satellite image right here, and behind me you're going to see that the skies are starting to clear out here in western Iowa. And the good news, at least from my perspective, is that we have no more rain in our forecast for about 6 or 7 days, and eastern Iowa really needs that. But when we come back, we do have some brand new crest information. We'll pass that along to you right after this. Welcome back, everyone. The National Weather Service and their hydrologists have been figuring the numbers here, and they have come in with some new ones. Hasn't changed dramatically, but we can at least update what we have. And the Cedar River in Vinton now has climbed up to 21.4 feet, so it is almost at what we were projecting was going to be the crest, but now that has come in just a little bit higher. It was 21.7, make that 21.5, now it's up to 21.7, so it went up 0.2 of a foot. That's in the Vinton area. And of course, going downstream then, Cedar Rapids is in line for the next round of rising water. And no changes indicated here. It is expected to stay level at 23 feet. So that's been about where it's been all day long, and that's where it's expected to stay here for the rest of tonight. So I think that number is pretty firm. Major flooding expected in Cedar Rapids with the crest at 7 a.m. Tuesday morning, 23 feet. And the river is rising rapidly now. It's nearly up to 16 feet on our latest gauge. And that is starting to be getting into the major flood category. And eventually it'll rise another 10 foot or so and get up there around 23 feet before this thing all crests. And again, there's the main river right through the middle of town. All these blue areas on either side of it is where the water goes at the 23 foot level. And as bad as that is, it is nowhere near as rough as we saw back in 2008. We have a graphic here to compare the two. This is 2016. You can see where the water goes. This was 2008 when we got it up to 31 feet, and you can see many, many areas on either side of the river flooded. The worst of it this time around is going to be on the west side of the river. As you can see, last time in 2008, both sides of the river experiencing a lot more flooding as a result of the big crest at 31 feet. So now we're anticipating crest levels here of about 6.5 days that will be at major or above flood stage. The worst of this is going to be in this period here where we have about 54 hours of 20 feet or greater. That is expected to occur as we get towards tomorrow night and right on through the day on Tuesday. Another area that's been hard hit by the flooding has been Independence. You can see here that the river was way out of its banks there, but it has now crested and it is beginning to fall in Independence, but that water is now heading towards Anamosa. You're expecting your second largest crest at around 24.1 feet, and that is expected on Wednesday morning. Our radars, though, are indicating a few light showers off to the east of us, but this is a major front, and it's really cooling down now around eastern Iowa. And with that front through the area, we are not expecting any more rainfall for the next 6 or 7 days. This is our rainfall forecast, which goes all the way out through Saturday, and you can see nothing of consequence around many parts of the Midwest. So things will really be drying out around here, and we can really use that. Also, plenty of sunshine expected in our forecast with dry weather and plenty of sunshine. the next several days. Temperatures, though, are really cooling down. And tonight we're going to see lows in the 40s in many areas, low 50s for a few spots in the south. Skies will be gradually clearing on out. And then as we go into tomorrow, sunny skies, much cooler conditions, a breezy day too. You'll know it's fall tomorrow with temperatures in that range of 63 to 68 degrees. And your long range forecast here is a really nice one for a change. As you can see, the temperatures are back in the 60s for several days, eventually getting back into the low 70s as we get towards Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And it's been a long time, you guys, since I've been able to show you a forecast that doesn't have any rain in it, particularly heavy rain. So some big improvement in that respect there.
It sure has. Look at all those sunshines.
Yeah.
Boy, do we need it.
The big bright orbs.
Yeah, hopefully so, folks can dry out.
Yep.
Thank you, Terry.
Still not any big changes on those crest levels here, so we were glad to see that too.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Very good.
Coming up, a sign of hope at one time is now a sign of worry. Right outside Newbo City Market in the Newbo District, you can see the HESCO barriers and all the sand. Let's hope it works, folks. We'll be right back.
It was the one they originally moved down.
Okay. So you're gonna do sports and pause to break?
That's what I just asked. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 sport.
And now, Fox 28 Sports with Pat Maroney.
In college football, every win is satisfying. Not all of them are pretty. And Iowa's victory over Rutgers on Saturday falls into the ugly category. On offense, the Hawks went just 3 for 11 on third down and threw for just 162 yards. On defense, they gave up 193 yards on the ground. But when it counted, down on the goal line, they made some plays, enough to get out of New Jersey with a win.
We just had a bend but don't break. Obviously, you don't want to be down there, but if you do find yourself down there, there's nothing you can do about it but just make plays. And we had our best guys show up and make plays. Josie found the ball. Desmond found the ball. And
I was very proud of how we fought out there. That was the main thing that we did. We kept fighting until the end of the game. We came here for one reason, one mission only, and that was to come out here and win the game and fight for the full 60 minutes. And as a team, I felt like we did that.
No Teddy Bridgewater, no Adrian Peterson, no problem for the Minnesota Vikings. They stunned the Packers last week to get to 2-0, and they continued to beat the odds this week. The Vikes in Charlotte to take on the defending NFC champion Panthers, down 8 in the second quarter, and special teams comes through. Marcus Sherrills gets some blocks, slips through the coverage team, and he is gone. 54 yards all the way to the house, and then in the second half, Sam Bradford fakes run and tosses it to Kyle Rudolph. He's too big and too strong. The Vikings get it done against the Panthers. They win 22-10. To Lambeau Field for the Packers and the Lions. The Pack came out with the guns blazing in this one. First quarter, Aaron Rodgers on the slant to Devontae Adams. Too easy. 7-0 Green Bay. Later in the quarter, Rodgers just makes his magic happen. Buys some time, finds Jordy Nelson for an 8-yard touchdown pass. Packers are rolling, and then up 24-3 in the second. Rodgers and Nelson do it again. A beautiful throw and catch. Those two have been doing that for years. Packers get to 2-0 with a 34-27 win. That's the Check of Sports. We'll be right back with more Flood 2016 coverage.
Last night, he was in Cedar Falls for us. He has moved downriver just a little bit. He is in Vinton. I'm speaking of Fox 28 meteorologist Jeff Kennedy, live in Vinton along the Cedar River. And it looks like it's really doing its thing up there, Jeff.
It is indeed, Scott. Yeah, good evening from Vinton, where the river is pretty high now at 21.4 feet. The updated crest forecast here is 21.7 feet, so that's just a bit of an adjustment. And the river continues to rise tonight. As I step out of the shot here, that is Celebration Park on the other side of the street. Everything there pretty much in the water. I took a walk over there earlier this afternoon, and I could walk almost up to the gazebo, so you can see how that has changed. The gazebo is now surrounded by the floodwater, as well as the picnic tables and the grills and the fire pit. The parking lot that we're in is Kirkwood's Vinton Center, and when we got here to Vinton this afternoon, there was no water in the parking lot. You can see now it's pretty shiny from about where we are all the way out toward the river. By the way, the river's about a block and a half that way, away from us, where the lights are shining there in the park. Now, the river's just on the other side of the park, and so the river continues to expand slowly here tonight. Vinton, as you're aware, there's a number of streets on this side of town. We're kind of on the northern side of Vinton. A lot of streets have been affected by the flood, so if you're coming to Vinton or if you live in Vinton, you will be affected by the flood here for days to come. The latest forecast says that the river will remain above flood stage here, Scott and Karen, until Thursday, so we'll be dealing with some closed-off streets here, I suspect, for several more days to come. I know Terry talked about the way this will be lasting for days, and that's indeed what will be happening here in Vinton. We're covering the corridor live tonight in Vinton. I'm Jeff Kennedy for Fox 28 News.
Thank you, Jeff, from Vinton. We've shown you that, and we'll show you much more ahead. So stay with us right here. We'll be right back.
Kevin Berry is bringing us an excellent picture of what's going on along the Cedar River and Cedar Rapids in the Newbow area. So we want to go back to Kevin right now to get an update from him. Kevin Berry.
Scott, we find ourselves on the other side of the wall now. We showed you that pump before. That's where the hoses come out. So if there's water on what's supposed to be the dry side in the sewer system, it gets pushed through a pump and it ends up right there. There's a sewer there. The problem, though, and we've been talking about this for a while and it's gotten a lot of attention on social media, is these buildings on the other side. There's four or five businesses here and buildings. Some of them were damaged in the flood before, and now specifically the owner of Tornadoes is very upset about the fact that he's on the wet side of this wall, and that while there's a lot of flood protection here, at least 8 feet, close to 12 feet in some spaces, you can see right here, this is wide open. This is meant to be the wet side of the flood protection barrier. Now, you can also see it's very dry. There's all the sand that went into these HESCO barriers. There, we haven't seen any water quite yet. It hasn't gotten high enough. We're not sure how high it will get, but if you look at some of these businesses, all that they had to do was to be able to sandbag for themselves while the city protected this. Now, we did this story yesterday. We talked to the city. We asked them why they didn't include some of these businesses in their protection. They said it's because this road right here, 16th Avenue, is the last place that they can put up those HESCO barriers where they are the most effective. That means that it's hard concrete. This is solid land. It's not grass. It's a paved roadway with not many potholes, but then also that it's on the highest elevation. They say as you go down that way, it starts to get uneven and it starts to get low, and even 8 to 12 feet worth of flood protection doesn't get you quite as much protection. So we've been here and the folks are actually inside Tornadoes. They say they're going to try to fight the floodwaters as it comes. They have pumps that they're manning, and they're going to try to push that water out over the barrier. But we just talked to them when we came out here. They're pretty upset about those hoses that I told you about before. They say that now they're taking what would be the city problem of water on the dry side of the flood protection and pushing it over to this side, making it part of their problem when they already had to fend for themselves. Again, we gave you the city side of this already. They say this is the best way to provide protection for the most amount of people. That doesn't help the folks at Tornadoes or any of these businesses, though. We're going to keep an eye on this situation, see how or if at all the water affects them here at Tornadoes and all these buildings as well. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Kevin Barry, Fox 28 News.
A lot of uncertainty. Thank you, Kevin. If you know someone is looking for a place to stay after being evacuated, or perhaps you need a place to stay, the Red Cross now has two shelters up and running in Cedar Rapids. One of them is at St. Paul's United Methodist Church, the other at Cedar Hills Community Church, and that is where we find Fox 28 News reporter Dora Miller. Dora, tell us about the residents coming in. I would imagine there are not that many right now, but more will be coming as the river gets closer to cresting.
That's right, Karen. I mean, what we've heard from Kara, she is from the Red Cross. She's been coordinating a lot of the activity here. She says that there's about 80 people, that's total combined with the two in St. Paul's and one here at Cedar Hills, that there have been about 80, almost 100 people that have come, but they are expecting more to come with the evacuation orders, and they're expecting more people to come in. But as far as donations that have been coming in, this is what they've been dealing with. This is all donated. All of this food is donated, from the water to the fruit, some of the home-baked goods. All of those are donated. And as you can see, like, it's just been an amazing show of generosity since this has begun. But if you'll take a walk with me, there are some housekeeping items that we have to take care of as far as donating. This schedule here is designed so that people know when lunch, breakfast, dinner is. And they're asking if you are going to bring food, make sure it's prepackaged and during the designated time. So obviously at lunch is at noon. If you want to bring it around that time, that will be great. Dinner is at 6, and so on. So they're asking that you do that. But if you are going to, please call ahead. A lot of organizations and businesses want to be generous, and they love the generosity. They accept it, but they don't want the food to go to waste. So if you are going to donate food or any kind of items, please make sure they're prepackaged, and please make sure you call ahead. So that's the schedule. Just one more look at that. And it's also lights out right now, so they try to cut the lights out around 10 o'clock and make sure that people can get the sleep that they need in order to be ready to experience what the unknown. But on that note, we'll send it back to you guys in the studio.
Dora is so right. The unknown and the uncertainty and the need for rest and sleep. So we hope they get a good night's sleep.
As we go to break, just a reminder that all the sandbagging staging areas in Cedar Rapids are now closed for the night. We'll be right back. We just showed you one of the shelters where evacuees can go. Now we're going to show you where they're coming from. Fox 28 News' Janae Ryan is live in the evacuation area. Janae?
Well, I'm out here in the evacuation zone, actually right on the edge of it. We are on 13th Street and H Avenue right up here. This is, like I said, right on the edge. So a lot of these people are still in their homes right now. But as you get farther into this neighborhood, past these road closed signs, they are a lot closed because this is in the evacuation zone. Further you get closer to the river, the more you can really it seeps in what is about to happen. Honestly, there are a lot more sandbags. There are a lot more evacuees going on back there. There is the evacuation that started at 8 p.m. tonight. It was voluntary, not mandatory, so you don't have to leave. And there is a curfew in right now. I've seen a lot of patrol cars come through here, and they're just making sure that anyone that's here needs to be here. No one, no looters, you know, whatever they may be here for. They just want to make sure it's people that live in this area. They are checking IDs. So if you need to come back to your home for any reason, make sure you have that identification to prove that you live here. And if you haven't evacuated yet, if you do want to leave, just make sure you grab, you know, the essentials that you need, clothing, any toiletries, make sure you have your ID papers, and also make sure to grab your pets. Now, when I was here today, seeing all of this, it really showed the kind of community that Cedar Rapids is. Everyone I spoke with had total strangers come up to help sandbag their homes. One home I talked with had over 100 people stop by today with trucks loads full of sandbags. They didn't have any, and by the end of the night, their home was completely sandbagged by 100 strangers help them do that. It's really amazing. And a lot of these people, this isn't the first time that they've had to do this. They were here for the 2008 floods. There was one family I spoke with that they had just moved into their house about a year and a half ago that was built by the Roots program from the home that was destroyed previously. So right now, everyone is just kind of crossing their fingers, trying to see, you know, what's going to happen tomorrow. And they are all hoping for the absolute very best, as of course all of us, and we will keep you updated on everything that is going on. Again, this evacuation is voluntary, and there is a curfew in until 7 a.m. tomorrow morning. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Janae Ryan, Fox 28 News.
Well, while it may seem like there is not a lot of activity in downtown Cedar Rapids tonight, of course, there is the curfew, so people are in their homes, or people have evacuated and they are with friends, family, or at a shelter. In the meantime, let's go back to Newbo, where CBS 2 News anchor Matt Hamill is live to show us more of what's happening down there. And Matt, the pictures you've shown us just look, like you put it, eerie.
Yeah, Karen, the answer to that question is there is absolutely nothing going on down here tonight. We have an occasional squad car that is running through the area. We have some people with city services that are coming through. And mostly it is what you see here at Newbo City Market. Things are shut down. The sandbags are out front. And now it's up to the river in terms of what's going to happen here. We were down here earlier today. We saw more sandbagging. We had a lot of kids from Coe College here. Probably 200 people at one point that were here sandbagging. Those sandbags being taken to areas around Newbo as well as over in Czech Village. And in some places, in some cases, all over town. We had a woman here who brought her truck in and said, I'm just taking sandbags wherever they are needed. And she continued to do that for the bulk of the afternoon. Here is some of the good news. The National Guard will arrive in the area tomorrow. That will give city staff and police an opportunity to spread out and do more of what they need to do. The National Guard 400 troops will be here to help with security. They can help with evacuations. Essentially, they told me tonight, we talked with Greg Hapgood with the Iowa National Guard, and the colonel says they essentially will do whatever the city needs them to do. They are here at the beck and call of whatever police and others in Cedar Rapids need them to do. We spent a lot of time down here in Newbo, and the business owners, as you might imagine, are pretty nervous. Some of them are new. They have not been in this area for very long, and they've never gone through a flood before. Our friends, Nate and Lindsay over at Eduscate, who are just on the opposite side of the street, they have the sandbags stacked to 5 feet. They're hoping for the best. They had to yank everything out of their store. Bruhemia, which has just moved into a new place, a new space in the old Chrome Horse building, they've only been in there for like 2.5 weeks. They're just getting started again, and they had to shut everything down, yank all of their equipment out again out of a beautiful new space, and have had to lock the doors and put sandbags up. So a lot of heartbreak, a lot of heartache for a lot of people, but they're just waiting now to see how long they will be out of their businesses. For now, guys, we'll send it back to you.
Thank you, Matt. I guess you could call this the calm before the crest. Kevin Berry, also in Newbo tonight, covering the area down there for us. Kevin?
We're out here by one of the businesses that was really created after the 2008 flood. Little House Artifacts is owned by Beth DeBoom, and that little red, or rather white heart with the red background, means that it was a house that was the object of Save CR Heritage. And so this was a house here that was lived in by a family, and I actually had a chance to walk through it a few years after the 2008 flood. There was still honey in the cupboard and still newspapers from 2008 in June when the flood walls came through, and Beth DeBoom was able to turn this into now her artifact store that she's had to completely and totally clear out because of the potential rising floodwaters. And you can take a look at just how close we are to the barricades. Right over there in the distance, you see our cars and two Cedar Rapids police cars who are patrolling around this area, making sure that there's nobody else out here who's doing anything wrong. And that's how close the water is to damaging this house again. And we spoke with Beth today, and she said not only would it be a financial imposition, she's put a lot of money into this, but it would be so heartbreaking because of all the work that she does to save not only this house, but then also a lot of the other houses too. We spoke a little bit earlier about the White Elephant building, and that's also hers as well. So a lot to think about, at least for that side of the Save CR Heritage Group. Covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids, Kevin Barry, Fox 28 News.
And once again, we'll go over some important crest information for you. Up around Vinton, the river is steadily rising, but not by much anymore. But it is up to 21.4 feet, and by tomorrow morning, it is expected to crest at 21.7 feet. That's 0.2 of a foot higher than what we were looking at earlier on today. So major flooding is ongoing in Vinton, and you're very close to the crest up there. But it looks like it's going to be a long duration crest, and we'll be around for at least 12 hours. And then as we get towards Cedar Rapids, still holding in there at a crest of 23 feet. That's the projection we've been at for about 12 hours now. No changes on the new updates from the National Weather Service. So major flooding isn't expected around here. And the crest itself should be close to 7 a.m. on Tuesday morning. That'll be the second highest crest ever in the Cedar Rapids area. And this is not the only river that's flooding right now. Take a look at the Wapsipinicon. This was earlier this afternoon around Independence, where there was some serious flooding going on there. But at least the river has crested in Independence. And now that wall of water is working its way down and should be towards Anamosa. 24.1, the crest expected there. That is down a couple 0.3 of a foot, but still major flooding anticipated in Anamosa, with the worst of it around 1 a.m. on Wednesday. Here's the radars, and you can see this front finally working its way east across eastern Iowa. This has been in the area now since the beginning of the week, but finally it's getting kicked out. Kicker is moving into the overall weather pattern, and now the jet stream is such that we will not be seeing these heavy rains anytime soon. Our rainfall forecast, which goes all the way out through Saturday, showing no additional rains of consequence here in eastern Iowa or much of the upper Midwest. So a much drier weather pattern is anticipated, and you could already see the skies have cleared out across the central and western parts of the nation. So we're expecting sun to be back in here for the next several days, and the temperatures are going to be much cooler. It's already dropped out there quite a bit tonight, and by tomorrow morning, lows will be in the 40s in a lot of spots, about 50 in Iowa City, 51 in Washington, and we'll go for 47 around Waterloo and Charles City. And tomorrow then, we'll get up to some pretty cool conditions, and it really won't warm all that much. Highs tomorrow should be back in the 60s, one of our cooler days of the season so far. And with that west wind out there at 30 miles an hour, the coat might just come in handy for some of you. Now, eventually, we do get into that drier pattern, and that shows up nicely here in our extended forecast. You can see we've got sunshine for Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and eventually temperatures warm back into the lower 70s for the next weekend that we'll be dealing with, but this one won't have any flooding, and by that time, things will have dried out, and the sunshine will be in our skies. A really nice and welcome change there.
All right, Terry, thank you. That is looking good for a lot of days in a row where people are going to need the sunshine. As you put it so well, Scott, this is the calm before the crest. As you know, the crest number is now 23. That's gone down from earlier predictions, but that is well above flood stage of 12 feet or so. And we hope that people have heeded the warning to evacuate the downtown area. If you haven't, it's too late tonight because of the curfew in effect till 7 a.m. tomorrow morning.
Hundreds of National Guard troops will be coming to Cedar Rapids tomorrow. They'll be deployed to actually secure the evacuation area and the flood zone, along with state troopers. We want to remind you that all sandbagging operations now in Cedar Rapids are closed. We also want to let you know, of course, you know by now that all Cedar Rapids schools, both public and parochial, are canceling classes both Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. Cedar Rapids schools are monitoring the situation. They will be sending updates to students and parents on Wednesday afternoon. The other thing that we should mention to you right now is the Edgewood Road Bridge across the Cedar River is closed because the city earlier tonight, shortly before 8 o'clock, they closed Edgewood Road between Glass Road and Ellis Road. Now, you know that intersection is right there by Ellis Park and the Manhattan Park area. You know that area floods, so that area is going to be in jeopardy. I know they brought in trucks to deliver dirt to build berms there, but the bridge across the river on Edgewood Road is now closed.
Also, if you need help, 211 is the number to call. Now,
from CBS 2 and Fox 28 News, this is special coverage of Flood 2016.
All eyes are on the Cedar River right now as we are waiting for the crest in Vinton, which is very close, even though they've raised the crest prediction. We'll get to more on that. Also, the crest in Cedar Rapids. We have a live look right now at the Cedar River in Vinton. The new crest prediction is 21.7, up from 21.5. We're going to check back in with CBS2 meteorologist Jeff Kennedy, who is tracking conditions on the river levels as they rise downstream. Good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight. We do have a lot of information to get to.
We begin with all the information that you need to know now. For example, Cedar Rapids schools are closed until Wednesday. District leaders say they will be sending more information to parents on Wednesday afternoon. They'll assess the situation. We'll know much more by then. You can find, by the way, a complete list of any closures that you may be wondering about at cbs2iowa.com.
You heard this on Fox 28 a moment ago. Now we are simulcasting on CBS 2 as well. The Edgewood Road Bridge across the Cedar River is closed. Crews shut down Edgewood Road between Glass Road and Ellis shortly before 8 o'clock tonight.
A curfew is in place for the evacuation areas in Cedar Rapids. That remains in effect until, like I said, 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. A curfew is also in place in Palo. That one remains in effect until 6 o'clock tomorrow morning. Again, these curfews are only for the evacuation areas. They will repeat until the flooding threat is over.
If you haven't yet secured your yardie cart, your recyclable can, your garbage can, please do so. City leaders are asking you to secure them, move them inside if that is possible, if you're inside the flood zone. There will be no trash removal within the flood zone, but trash service will continue as normal outside of the flood-affected areas. Also, the city says it is going to be flexible with extra bags and trash at locations outside the evacuation zone. And we take a look at this CBS2 Fox 28 News drone high above downtown Cedar Rapids tonight. Right at sunset, we took these pictures. When the sun comes up tomorrow, it's going to be a much different picture along the flooded Cedar River. And it will be days, maybe weeks before life returns to normal.
It is such an amazing picture via the drone, and yet it's going to get so much worse. A live look at the Cedar River as you just saw. In the meantime, let's go to Chief Meteorologist Terry Swales for the latest information. Terry, this is a good thing that we're at about 23 on the crest stage.
Yeah, we haven't budged on that now for about 12 hours straight. So we're pretty confident that's about where the river is going to end up in Cedar Rapids. But right now, the crest is very close west of Vinton. It's slowly going up there, but by tomorrow morning, we should be in Crest, and that is expected to reach about 21.7 feet. And that is major flooding and the second largest flood to occur in the Vinton area. Of course, the previous one was back in 2008. And it's the same story for Cedar Rapids. We're expecting our second largest crest here at 23 feet, so that is well above the flood stage of 12 foot. And we are going to have major flooding, and it's already beginning to happen out there. On our latest report from our hydrograph, it's now up to nearly 16 feet, the river here in Cedar Rapids. That's where major flooding starts and will continue to rapidly rise towards that 23-foot level and the crest sometime late Monday night or very early in the day on Tuesday. And a lot of real estate will be flooded around Cedar Rapids. And most importantly, if you're going to be out and about for that morning commute, a lot of the roads in Cedar Rapids have been closed or shut down. It's going to be a slow going out there. You'll want to plan for some extra time, and you may need to go in an alternate route because some of these roads are definitely closed and probably for some time to come. Another area that's seen some big flooding today has been on the Wapsie River around Independence. This picture taken late this afternoon by Blake Hayward shows the flooding there impacting some of the businesses in the downtown area. That crest continues to head towards Anamosa, and you should crest around 1 a.m. on Wednesday morning at 24.1 feet, also the second largest crest in Anamosa. But here's the good news. Our front that's been around for several days to come is now moving out of eastern Iowa. Drier and cooler weather is in the forecast now right on into the upcoming weekend.
So right now, the Wapsie River has reached its crest in Independence. The Highway 150 bridge there is now closed because water is at the bottom of the bridge deck. As Terry mentioned just a few minutes ago, the river crested about 8 foot above flood stage and is now going down. Vinton is now waiting for the Cedar to crest.
CBS 2 News meteorologist Jeff Kennedy begins our Flood 2016 live team coverage with what's happening right now in Vinton. And Jeff, we've been watching you over the past couple of days. The parking lot was bone dry and now it's all water behind you.
Yeah, Karen and Scott, good evening from Vinton, where my feet are going to get wet here in just a couple minutes. The water continues to come toward us from the Cedar River, which is behind me about a block and a half or so. So I'll step out of the screen here and Scott can show you that Celebration Park there on the other side of the street. And the river's about a block and a half or so beyond where we are right now. We chose to come to a Kirkwood's Vinton Center parking lot and just stay out of the floodwater. But you can see the gazebo there in the park is surrounded by the floodwater, the grills, the picnic tables, all the walking trails through the park, they're underwater. And the river continues to come up slowly. It's now at 21.4 feet here. And as Terry mentioned, the updated crest now says 21.7 feet. So we're pretty close to the crest here in Vinton right now. We followed the crest downstream. We were in Cedar Falls last night when the river crested. So now it's down about 30 miles farther south, and it will be continuing to press on toward the southeast over the course of the next couple days. And as Terry's been showing you already, Cedar Rapids seeing some dramatic rises in the river. That'll continue over the next couple days. And same story here in Vinton. We have a number of street closures, a lot of streets just underwater right now. And we'll be dealing with this high water here in Vinton, folks, for the next several days. The forecast here says that the river will remain above flood stage right on into Thursday. 21.4 the number now. The forecast crest, 21.7. We're covering the corridor live in Vinton tonight. I'm Jeff Kennedy for CBS 2 News.
We want to thank everyone for watching tonight. You know, a lot of people get their news on Facebook, and this is what they've seen. Sandbagging, community coming together. It's just been absolutely incredible, the camaraderie from people of all walks of life, kids, grandparents, moms, dads, everybody pitching in to sandbag. About an hour ago, Cedar Rapids city leaders announced they have closed all sandbagging locations in the city.
And as the minutes pass, we all collectively take a breath and we are waiting to see if all of the preparations will hold back the flood. The Cedar has been rising steadily all day. CBS 2 News reporter anchor Kevin Berry is out in the evacuation area near the water. Kevin, you've been able to get some close to some areas that the average person cannot go in. Tell us what you're seeing and where you are.
No, absolutely. We've been very close to the water. We were actually up on top of one of the barricades. That's not recommended. You shouldn't do it. The Cedar Rapids Police Department actually came out and asked us to come down, and we did. But what we were able to see is the river starting to rise a lot more, and we were down on another part at a bike trail that's already been flooded so far. And so that water is steadily rising, and it's easy to see how it's going to start to affect some of downtown. If the worst happens and the water does start to come over the barricades, or it starts coming up through the sewer system, this is one of the big pieces of machinery that's going to try to remedy that. It's a big pump that's hooked up into a sewer line, goes directly into the sewer. So if that water starts to back up from underneath, which is truthfully where it's going to come from first, this pump is going to be able to send it through these hoses right over the top. And we were just able to see where they empty out. There's a sewer just on the other side. Now, some of these businesses don't feel too great about that. You see kickstand sign right there. Tornadoes is all the way down that way. The city would be taking this water and putting it on the other side. Some of those businesses are not happy. We did talk to the city yesterday, and like we told you in the Fox 28 News at 9 and the CBS News at 10 last night, the city says this was simply the best place that they would be able to mostly safely protect everybody that would be on this dry side of the land. So unfortunately, there are some buildings and some investments that would be on the wet side and have to take some of that water on potentially. But they say that this is the best way to ensure that most of the people over here stay dry so far tonight. We're going to be tracking the situation, see if any water comes on over here with the crest falling over the past few days. That's been helpful for some of those folks. They say they feel a little bit better about it. We'll keep watching it. You can keep watching it right here. We're covering the corridor in Cedar Rapids. Kevin Barry, CBS 2 News, 10 at 10.
You know, we are keeping a close eye on Newbo. A lot of people think of that area as a place to go see art and a place to go see the city market and a place to go to restaurants. The entrepreneurial community down in Newbo is unbelievable. The very first Iowa Startup Accelerator is down there, and so is CBS 2 News reporter Matt Hamill. He is in the heart of it to show us, really, the calm before the crest. Matt.
Boy, that's for sure, Scott. You know, for the last 48 hours, we have had sandbagging going on right here, nonstop, filling bags for 2 days straight, all the way around the clock. As you mentioned, those operations now shut down. This one moved out of the area earlier today, but take a look at what was going on right up until that moment. Boy, the guys from Coe College and the women from Coe College, they showed up in force to fill thousands of sandbags as people came to load up and protect their houses all around the community. Some of the volunteers lost homes to flooding 8 years ago. Wendy Dunn even showed up with her truck and drove sandbags to Check Village and all around town.
I happen to have a truck, so I thought I'd help out by hauling bags wherever they tell me to go.
You just been going place to place just to see who needs
absolutely,
help?
Absolutely, yeah, to see whoever needs the most help is where we're headed.
I felt helpless in 2008. And I could barely even help myself. And I'm in a totally different place now that now I'm actually able to help others.
The market completely shut down, bagged up. Business owners in Newbo reminding us that the water levels may be high for a few days. Cleanup may take several days, but they say it could be so much longer than that before they get everything back online and can get the doors open. The folks at Eduscape told us they said they'll be happy just to be back in with the doors open by Halloween. Covering the corridor tonight in Newbo, Matt Himmel, CBS 2 News, 10 at 10.
Right now, curfew and evacuations are in effect along the river there in Cedar Rapids. CBS 2 News anchor Janae Ryan joins us now from the evacuation zone. Janae?
Yeah, Scott, I've been in the evacuation flood zone area all day, and I've never seen anything like it. Right now, I'm on 13th Street and H Avenue Northwest, right on the edge of the evacuation zone. So most of these people are still in their homes. Not a whole lot of sandbagging scene here, but as you get further and further in, of course, closer to the river, more and more. Right here is the edge, like I said, so we have a road closure sign, and it just gets further in as the evacuation area. And today, when I came out here, I expected to see a lot of panic and a lot of chaos and fear because of this looming flood, but that's not what I saw. What I saw was teamwork and caring and a lot of selflessness and just very, very calm. And of course, the calm was here because this isn't everyone's first rodeo. There are a lot of people that have experienced this before. Now, this home that you're seeing right here is owned by Ron and Heidi McKay. They evacuated this same home back in the 2008 floods. Now, since then, they actually had to gut the whole house and they redid the whole thing inside by hand, which is making this evacuation so much more painful. But they say that they are thankful because this time they at least had days to prepare rather than last time they only had hours.
We're better prepared now, and we decided that no matter what, we were taking everything this time. We were not going to put anything upstairs. It was all coming out.
Now, the McKays are staying with their family right now, and they're really hoping that this time they can come back to their home in maybe a matter of weeks rather than a matter of months, and that they hopefully don't have to redo anything this time because they hope that their home is prepared now. Now, again, the evacuations from here on back are voluntary, not mandatory, but they are highly recommended by city officials, and there is a curfew in place right now until 7 a.m. I've seen the officers patrolling around. They're just making sure no one's here that doesn't need to be here. If you do live in this area, you need to come back for something to your home and you've evacuated, just make sure you have your ID to prove that you do need to be here and you do live here. And if you do evacuate your home after now, make sure to grab the essentials, make sure to grab medications, any important paperwork, and of course, never forget to grab your pets. Covering the corridor live in Cedar Rapids, Janae Ryan, CBS 2 News.
Thankfully, there are now two Red Cross shelters open in Cedar Rapids where folks can go. People needing to evacuate can go to St. Paul's United Methodist Church on 3rd Avenue Southeast. There's also a shelter open at Cedar Hills Community Church on E Avenue Northwest. CBS 2 News reporter Dora Miller is at the Cedar Hills shelter tonight. Dora?
Well, Scott, right now it is lights out. It's been lights out for about 10 minutes. So right behind me in this room here behind these doors, people are sleeping right about now. They're just getting rest to prepare for what's next in the few days. They don't know. It's pretty much the unknown for them. But if you're looking for a place to stay in this shelter, there is plenty of room. We were told by Red Cross today that this whole area here is open. There are hundreds of people that are expected to be flowing in within the next few days. But there are a few things that you should know if you would like to stay in a shelter. First, if you have any medications, you are asked to bring those medications with you. Dietary needs, you're asked to have those with you as well so that you can take care of yourself and so that the staff here knows exactly what you need. They're also asking for proof of residency to show that you do live in the flood zone to make sure that you are legitimately needing a place to stay. Now, they are open 24 hours, so if you're looking for a place to stay right now, they will take you in, and they have open arms, so they're ready for you if you need to do that. We also talked to a woman earlier today who is sleeping now but said before she couldn't get very much rest because this is her first time in a shelter, and she has not experienced a flood like this. She lived in Marion in 2008, but she says right now the generosity of the Red Cross volunteers and the people here that have given food, their time, and their love for her and her family has been overwhelming. And that's just kind of what we're seeing here since we've gotten here earlier today, just the generosity of people, donations of food coming in, and everything that people really need here in this city. So from the Red Cross volunteers and the people here, they just want to say thank you. For now, we are in Cedar Rapids. We'll send it back to you guys in the studio.
One of Cedar Rapids' most iconic buildings got a little help preparing for the flood. Cedar Rapids Carpenters Union Local 308 showed up at the Paramount Theater with power tools to take apart the nearly 100 seats on the first level. Then a small army of volunteers streamed in to carry those seats to higher ground. Local 308 says they take pride in what they helped build.
Yeah, absolutely. This is our community. We were devastated after the 2008 flood, so we want to take pride in our community and help out wherever we can.
Local 308 has been teaming up over the past few days to help family members and anyone else pack up their homes to save possessions before the flooding begins.
Another well-known stop for entertainment, completely bare inside right now. You know Parlor City. When it's full of activity and people having a good time listening to the great musicians we have in this community, well, they took out all the tables and all the seating so they could keep everything dry before the water comes in. The owners say, John Jelinek and the crew down there, you know, they They lost a lot back in 2008, so this time they didn't want to take any chances. People in Palo evacuated their homes today. And by the way, if you live in Palo, I'm sure you've heard you're not allowed to be drinking the water there because they had a water main break. There is bottled water that's available at City Hall if you need it. But again, evacuations and sandbagging efforts. We hope this community doesn't have to go through what they went through back in 2008. It was devastating for them.
And we want to talk now to Chief Meteorologist Terry Swales to find out just where the predictions are at this moment.
Yeah, but before we get to that, I want you to take a look at this satellite and check this out. From Iowa all the way to the Pacific Ocean, not a cloud in the sky, guys. So that is really good news because it means the forecast is going to be dry and sunny, and that'll really help as we prepare for the crests, which are headed our way. We'll have all the latest information for you there in your Weather First forecast next.
You know, there are similarities to this flood and the 2008 flood, but it's actually quite unique unto itself.
Weather First meteorologist Rebecca Kopelman joins us now with more on that angle.
Well, we talked about all the history behind the Cedar River and Cedar Rapids, and yesterday we told you that this will be the second time in 165 years that the Cedar River will exceed 20 feet. But it will actually be the first time since 1851, as far as our records go back, that a crest will occur in the month of September. Typically, if we take a look back, we have several that occur during the months of March and April, which are due to snowmelt crests, which in the top 30 crests, the last top 30 have been about 13 times. The largest typically occur with heavy rain events between the months of May and August, which are 17. And in 2008, it occurred in June, but was actually a result of two years with heavy rainfall and a combination of the snowmelt that led to that rise in the river that got up to a crest of 31 feet. This projection is lower than that, but it will make history, and it will be the first time in 165 years that we have the river going above flood stage in the month of September and in the fall season. And Chief Meteorologist Terry Swales is here now with all the latest information and some more historical context.
Thanks, Rebecca. Some very interesting information. And we dug back into the archives here because, as you mentioned, we have records that go all the way back to 1851. And we came up with a couple of pretty interesting pictures to show you. And this was in Cedar Rapids at Riverside Park way back in 1900. And you can see the people going down by the river to see what was going on there. No cars back in those days. So if you wanted to come in from the outside, you had to ride the horse or take your bicycle in. Thought that was kind of interesting. And this picture was taken in 1929, and this is in downtown Cedar Rapids around 12th Avenue and 3rd Street. And you can see the water was pretty deep there, but by that time, at least they had some cars. And on this next picture, no cars traveling this road here. This was Highway 218, and we're up to Cedar Falls now, and you can see a flood there in 1961 really tore up the roads and caused a lot of havoc up that way. So floods have been a part of our history for many, many years, but few of them have been as big as this one on the Cedar River. And now we're going to take a look at some of the flood crests. And in Vinton, you're getting real close right now. You're expected to be at 21.7 there, and that's tomorrow morning. But right now we're at 21.4 feet, so really pushing that. Major flooding expected up that way, and it's happening right now. In Cedar Rapids, the river is quickly on the rise now. Flood stage is 12 feet, and we think the crest will be right around that 23-foot mark, and it is still expected at around 7 a.m. on Tuesday morning. Major flooding here, and this would be the second highest crest on record. Right now the river is nearly up to 16 feet in Cedar Rapids, and it's rising rapidly now. So between now and the next, we'll say 12 to 18 hours, we're going to be pushing 20 feet, and then eventually we get our crest at 23 feet on Tuesday morning. So watch how that water just rapidly goes up and then actually goes down pretty quickly once we get past the crest sometime on Wednesday afternoon. And here's the main stem of the Cedar River running right through the middle of town. When we get a 23-foot crest, you can see how it extends into these blue areas. Going to be a lot of residential areas impacted and potentially some of the downtown. Hopefully the flooding protection works, but there is definitely going to be a lot of roads closed in this area, and so you may want to get some extra time planned in for tomorrow morning if you're out there in the morning commute, or you may even need to have an alternative route because a lot of roads are closed. And this is what we're expecting for the river and how much we're going to be above that flood stage. And we're looking now at about 6.5 consecutive days here where we'll be above the flood stage of 12 feet in Cedar Rapids. But here's where things really get ugly. There's going to be about 54 hours where we're above that 20-foot crest. So that's going to be pretty nasty, and that really occurs once we get into later Monday and into the nighttime hours on Tuesday night, and then things should start to improve. Another part of our region that's had some issues today was on the Wapsie River up around Independence. Blake Hayward sending us this picture here. There's the river, but it goes way beyond that and was impacting some of the downtown businesses there. The river is falling now in Independence, so we've had the crest there about 8 feet above flood stage, and now we're looking at Anamosa next in line, and the crest there should be around 1 o'clock in the morning on Wednesday, and it's going to be way up there at 24.1 feet. That's the second highest crest ever in Anamosa. Now, getting to the actual weather here, you can see a front has now pushed out of eastern Iowa, and this front has been impacting our weather since Monday, bringing heavy showers and thunderstorms. Well, now it's finally to the east of us, and our weather is expected to improve dramatically. We do not have any additional rainfall in the forecast now all the way through the upcoming weekend, and you can see the skies are already clearing out in our western counties, and all this sunshine will be around for the rest of the week. And with no additional rain, the weather going to be a lot better around the Midwest. But one thing I can assure you, it's going to be a lot cooler too. These are the low temperatures tonight, and they're going to be back down around 47 to 48 in the north, lower 50s in the south. Skies clearing on out. Tomorrow then, we do have some sunshine around, but it's going to be windy and much cooler. A light coat probably going to come in handy, at least through the morning hours. High temperatures only in the low 60s north to the upper 60s in our southern counties. Here's your extended forecast. And Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, there's the sunshine at 67. After that, Thursday and Friday and Saturday, still looking dry. Temperatures overall in the mid-60s to around 70 degrees. So those readings start out cool, but back to normal by the time that period ends. But gosh, it's been a long time since we've had 7 consecutive days with no rain, you two.
Absolutely. You know, with the major flooding expected in parts of Cedar Rapids and beyond, help is coming from the Iowa National Guard. CBS 2 News anchor Matt Hamill joining us live from the Newbold District with the latest information on that. Matt?
Yes, Scott, Nubo is absolutely a ghost town tonight. This is one of the evacuation areas, and people have heeded the warnings and are pretty much gone tonight. Sandbags and a lot of dark buildings, no one living in the lofts down here. Obviously, the business is all closed, a little bit of maintenance work and a few police cars running by, and as you might imagine, that can make people a little nervous about leaving their homes and businesses behind. But tomorrow, 400 National Guard troops will be moving into the area. Today, volunteers turned out in a big way once again in Nubo to help with sandbagging and then take those bags to protect homes and businesses all over the city. But by tomorrow, of course, a lot of those volunteers will be headed back to work and college, and that's when the Guard will step in, especially in areas where the water is rising fast.
Part of that mission will be working at the evacuation control points, which is to kind of help things moving smoothly for people that need to evacuate certain areas. They'll be on the ground and ready to do the mission sometime early tomorrow afternoon.
Colonel Hapgood says they will be available to do whatever the city wants, and they're bringing in special equipment, vehicles that can travel in very high water if necessary to assist with those evacuations if need be. Covering the corridor tonight in Nubo, Matt Hamill, CBS 2 News, 10 at 10.
Local first responders are now stationed on both sides of the river. Crews say there are police and firefighters ready with boats and specialty equipment. Since all bridges are closed, I-380 will be the only way for first responders to get to emergency calls, and some 380 exits are closed for emergency and construction crews only. So, if you're driving along 380 and they're asking people to be patient and allow more time for travel.
That's what we're here for. We're here to help people, and we have a mission to not only respond to the flood event, but to help our citizenry that aren't directly impacted in the flood evacuation zone as well.
Greg Bulow says there was a designated emergency car lane on I-380 during the flood back in 2008. Right now there isn't one, but city officials say they will make plans if needed.
If you or someone you know is looking for a place to stay after being evacuated, the Red Cross now has two shelters set up and running in Cedar Rapids. CBS 2 News reporter Dora Miller is at one of the churches welcoming residents, and she joins us now live. Dora, you know, you've talked to the folks who are running that, the Red Cross. Is there any talk that they may open a third shelter if needed?
Well, Karen, that is absolutely a possibility. If they do become overflowing here and at St. Paul's, they said that they will open another shelter. They are prepared to do that. It is on standby. We don't know the exact location right now, but they said do not worry. If hundreds of people need a place to stay, they will provide hundreds of cots for them. But right now we are at Cedar Hills Community Church, where there's about 80 people between St. Paul's and here that have been seeking shelter. And right now it's bedtime for them, but earlier today they were up and running around. Some of the things that they were able to do, because they are keeping the kids busy, is some of these games over here that they have. They're making sure that everybody is happy and making sure that the kids are smiling and just taking away from some of the uncertainty that they might be facing right now. They also had a lot of generous donations as far as food goes. So this whole kitchen here, this is donated by the generous people in this community. So they have just been overwhelmed with the feeling of gratitude and the feeling of love that they've received from people in the community. But if you are interested in donating, there are a few housekeeping items that we have to talk about. First off, there is a schedule. So there's a breakfast, lunch, and dinner time. Breakfast is at 7, lunch at noon, dinner at 6. And they're asking, if you do want to donate food, that you call ahead and go by this schedule. For example, if you want to offer something for dinner, that you call ahead and make sure that the meal is prepackaged so that you are making it as safe as possible for the people here. They don't want to waste food, so they are asking that you do call ahead just for that purpose. And they also appreciate baked goods, but right now they're looking more for prepackaged foods if that is something that they're in need of, just because they want to make sure that everybody is as safe as possible. And as you can see there, it's lights out time right now, like I mentioned before. So on that note, we'll send it back to you guys in the studio.
All right, Dora, thank you. We hope they all get a good night's sleep. In the meantime, this place, Capri College, is now offering its facility to licensed stylist professionals who were displaced during the flood. If you'd like to continue serving your clients during this time, you are invited to use space at Capri College for free. Cosmetologists, massage therapists, and any other professional stylists will have a home with a salon chair. There are wax rooms and private massage areas at Capri. The only request they have is that you are a licensed professional.
We will do whatever we can to make sure that everyone has a place to meet their clients and see their clients, because sometimes just seeing our favorite ladies that come in every week puts a smile on our face.
Capri College says it will stay open as long as stylists need the space. Both locations in Cedar Rapids and Waterloo will start accepting stylists immediately.
The CBS 2 and Fox 28 News drone has been capturing the impact of Flood 2016 all day. This is footage of flooding in Cedar Rapids. It's been on the rise, the Cedar, all day long. As a matter of fact, right now we just got an update. It is over 16 feet as we speak, and that is major flood stage. CBS 2 News will be back in 2 minutes.
CBS 2 connects with the corridor. Call us at 1-800-222-KGAN. Email us at news@cbs2iowa.com. Or connect with us on Facebook at facebook.com/KGANCBS2. Listen throughout the day for your weather first forecast on 104.5 KDAT when you're away from your TV.
Just about an hour ago, Cedar Rapids Mayor Ron Corbett was here in the studio to discuss where things stand right now. I wanted to talk about the voluntary evacuations that are underway right now. People were supposed to have evacuated by 8 o'clock tonight. Why is it important for people to heed the voluntary evacuation request?
Well, it's important from a safety standpoint, their personal safety, but also potentially putting at risk firefighters and emergency rescue personnel in the event that they would have to rescue someone. So if you're watching this at home right now and you're sitting in your living room in the inundated area, you know, I plead with you to go grab your suitcase or your duffel bag, put some clothes in it, some medication, maybe some toiletries, and please just move out. It's only for a short period of time through today, and we think we can get everybody at least have access to their place on Saturday. Please do this. We've built this levee system to prevent flooding on all both sides of the river, and we're working with the Corps of Engineers on that, but there's always the possibility these temporary systems, you know, could breach, and you know, that's our biggest concern right now. And so the rising water is one thing, but when you have a breach in a levee that's holding back, you know, 20 feet, 30 feet, or 23 feet of water, and there's a breach, that comes gushing out, and that's a concern. And one of the reasons we ask people to, you know, please respect the evacuation order and move out.
Coupling the evacuation order is the curfew that is now in effect until 7 a.m. What's the purpose of the curfew, Mayor?
Well, a lot of people have posted a lot of pictures on social media about the flood protection system that's been built in the last 72 hours. It's an amazing effort by the workers and the community, but it's not a tourist site. It is a flood protection system, and we don't need people walking. We don't need people riding their bicycles and motorcycles or cars. This is not an area we want you to be in. So, you know, please, you know, respect that evacuation. We're doing it for a reason, for safety. So as tempting as it may be to want to come down and look at it, we ask you not to do that. And tomorrow when people are, you know, going to work, there will be some traffic challenges with only Wilson Avenue and 7th open. You know, it's tempting to drive on 380 and look over your shoulder at the right, river, right, and then you slow down. It's a difficult section of the road anyway, as it is, the S-curve. So please use caution in the morning, and because there will be more traffic on 380 than normally would because of the exit ramps that are closed.
We've been reporting on the National Guard that will be coming to Cedar Rapids, several hundred National Guard members, as well as state troopers, to assist in security. Is that what they're coming primarily for, is to secure the area, the perimeter around the evacuation?
Yeah, so the inundation area that we've designated as, you know, where the flooding would take place, we have checkpoints that we want to make sure that people aren't going in. The National Guard will serve that purpose. So they should be in place by noon tomorrow. We're meeting with the Corps of Engineers in the morning to discuss the levee system and any issues that there may be with that. We think it's in great shape. We're doing all the last minute inspections and work this evening. But there's always that possibility, so we bring in the Corps. They're experts. It's been a great 72 hours, a great rally for the city. You know, now we have to deal. This is the dangerous part, and so if you live in that area, get out. And if you're not in that area, stay out.
You have worked in both the public and private sector. What are you hearing from the business community downtown right now as we near this crest?
Well, most of the business community made their preparations very quickly. They knew that this crest was going to come late Monday or Tuesday. They weren't sure. So most of them, by Friday, made plans to relocate this week. So the business community is doing that. They're relocating. We just want the homeowners out there that may be watching tonight that are still in their home and thinking this isn't going to be bad and I can stay here. Hopefully the first line of protection system works, but in the event of a breach, it could cause some big problems, and so safety is our number one concern right now.
Cedar Rapids Mayor Ron Corbett. We'll be right back. Tomorrow is a very big day, isn't it, Terry?
It sure enough is. Crest Day was in Vinton today, and tomorrow it's getting really, really close to us, and we are anticipating crest to be up there in the second highest levels ever in Cedar Rapids, so it's going to be a big one. But you can see at least up over in the Wapsie River, it has crested in Independence, so that is good news there, and the river continues to move downstream. Anamosa is next in line, a 24.1-foot crest there, expected Wednesday at 1 a.m. That would be the second highest crest ever in Anamosa. And as we mentioned in Vinton, the river is near crest now, up around 21.4 feet, And so anytime between now and tomorrow morning, the crest will occur at about 21.7 feet. And in Cedar Rapids, we seem to be locked into that 23-foot number now, so that's looking very solid. And the crest should occur around 7 o'clock in the morning on Tuesday, our second largest crest ever behind the 31-foot level of 2008. And we've just got this in. The river has now climbed to 16.2 feet in Cedar Rapids. It's rising rapidly and will continue to do so until we reach the crest early on Tuesday morning.
These are records we do not want to break, unfortunately.
That's
true. And there we go.
We thought it'd be a long time before we had to deal with this again here in Cedar Rapids.
Boy, did we.
If you're still awake with us tonight and are in need of help, 211. Keep that number handy. Use it if you need it. If you are looking to volunteer, the United Way has asked you to sign up online on the United Way of East Central Iowa's website. All you have to do is click Volunteer Now. We have placed that information on our website, cbs2iowa.com.
We will continue bringing you the latest information as we get it. You can download the CBS2 Weather app. It's free for Apple and Android devices. Just search your favorite app store for CBS2WX. We're also constantly posting up-to-the-minute information on cbs2iowa.com. Fox28Iowa.com. If you can safely take pictures without being in the way of those evacuating or the recovery efforts, go ahead and send them to us. We'd love to see your perspective and we'll share them with our viewers. You can connect with us anytime on Facebook at KGAN CBS2 and on Twitter at CBS2Iowa.
Thank you so much for staying up late for this late edition of CBS2 News simulcast on Fox 28 as well. Be sure to wake up with CBS2 this morning, which starts early at 4:30 tomorrow morning. Until then, stay safe, sleep well.